We've talked a lot about American television evangelists on this show, and we've talked a lot about transsexuals. But so far, American television evangelist transsexuals have been a neglected field. In their country of origin, they are a vocal minority, and no one is more vocal than Larry Nielsen, otherwise known as Sister Paula. Sister Paula has her own little show on cable, on which she proves she is no shrinking violet, although she might conceivably be a shrinking Victor.
Stop! Whatever it is you're doing right now, for you are about to witness scenes of the most unique, creative, and controversial form of televangelism in the United States today. Time and time again, God keeps trying to say to the church world, and they can't seem to grasp it. Preachers are just as human as anyone else.
Sister Paula and God understand each other, which just leaves us. We are sometimes slow to accept that judgment, like vengeance, belongs to the Lord. But why don't we seek guidance from Sister Paula herself, currently ready to join us by satellite from her earthly base in Portland, Oregon. Can you hear me, Sister Paula?
Yes, I can.
Paula, you're looking absolutely sensational. Where do you get those clothes?
Well, you don't get them off of the rack at Sears and Roebuck or Motor Day or in a retail store, that's for sure. This is a show business outfit that I wear as a cabaret entertainer in a nightclub here in Portland, although I've also preached the gospel on television in this very outfit that you're looking at right now. But we get the fabric from various theatrical fabric companies in New York, and then I have colleagues in show business here that make the wardrobe for me. I myself don't sew, but I know several here in Portland that make the dresses for me, and a very dear friend of mine made this outfit for me.
I presume that magnificent head of hair isn't entirely yours.
No, it's not, although sometimes on my cable television show I do use my own hair, but this here is a wig, and it's got a hard on, as you can see.
Welcome back to the most listened to radio program around. It is the Sir Daryl Radio Experience. It's time for one of our favorite segments on the show. It's time to introduce, my favorite, but I think that I would probably say the only transgendered preacher that I know. It's time for Sister Paula.
This is my story.
Theme music could only mean one thing. It's time to bring on Sister Paula.
Yes.
How are you today?
Oh, not bad. You were talking to your last guest about cemeteries. Was that about the grave robbing that was going on?
Yes.
I saw that on TV. I think that was in Chicago area.
That was in the Chicagoland area. That's right. And so it prompted me to make a call to a cemetery. Just, you know, Sister Paula, actually, it leads into what I want to talk to you about today. I can make jokes or make lighthearted calls like that because I have never been afraid of death. And I wonder as we get older whether or not that starts to change because I'm now almost 40 years old. I'll be 40 next year. I haven't changed really my stance as long as I can remember. I'm wondering what makes a person secure enough to not fear death, or is that a sign of insanity?
I think that everybody kind of deep down inside has the fear of death to a certain point. You know, I almost died 4 years ago. I came real close, you know, if it wasn't a death experience, it was a near-death experience.
You know, I first found out about Sister Paula when she released a video endorsing Hillary Clinton for presidency of the United States of America. And I don't know how I came across this video. It was on YouTube. But I came across it, and I looked at it, and I who is this woman? And I looked at it a little bit further, and I went to her website, and I saw that she was a preacher that was transgendered. Now, you got to understand something. That flies in the face of everything that we've been taught. That flies in the face of everything that we're supposed to be believing in. So I had her on the show, and the conversation went so well that after the show, I said, let me write this woman and see whether or not she might be willing to come on regularly. And she accepted, and we've been having her on ever since.
Do you ever give any thought, though, to your legacy as to how you would want to be remembered?
Oh, yes. Well, lots of it, because that's the reason we're working on a documentary, and also I'm writing my biography, autobiography. I want people to remember me and read about me after I'm gone, and maybe people will find comfort from my life story, from their troubles. And I believe that that was why God spared my life 4 years ago. And because, you know, the film documentary and the autobiography is going to be my legacy.
At what point did you decide you wanted to start writing this, but when did it enter your mind?
Oh, that's been on my mind for a long time, for at least 20 years, if not longer.
You know, I have been working or attempting to write my autobiography, my life's story. This morning I was getting ready for the day's events, knowing that we were going to be taping the television program today, when all of a sudden I felt that inner voice, that still small voice, say to me, why don't you start telling your life story on the Sister Paula television show? Go back to the very beginning and do a series of shows on your life. And I said to the Lord, or to that inner voice, or however you want to put it, all right, I'll do it. I was born July the 13th, 1938, at St. Vincent's Hospital in Northwest Portland. My mother was a homemaker. My father was a womanizer and liked to go out and drink. He was a longshoreman.
Now, you were talking about your father having a strong voice.
Oh, yes, he did. Very deep, strong voice. He was tall. I get, but two things that I get from my father are my height and my loud, strong voice.
But I remember the day when I was 4 years old, when my mother came home from the hospital, having given birth to my sister, Teresa.
And as far as stubborn mom, you can't, you tell mom something, you will not, nobody's telling me what to do. And Paula's very much like that. Well, I remember mom saying that my father was like a big baby. Now, and would get mad about losing at a card game or whatever and go upstairs and pout. And Paula admitted that she got upset. This is funny, over not winning at bingo, and she didn't want to go back again or something. And that's a trait there too of the father, of wanting to win, I think, you know.
In speaking of those days, my mother tells me that I, quote, raised hell, unquote. And many a time I had to get a spanking to calm me down.
My very first day in kindergarten, 65 years ago, 5 years old, my first day in school in kindergarten, and I was standing, getting ready to go up to the steps to go in the classroom, and all these kids were going in and they were pointing at me and laughing at me and making fun of me. And I remember the thoughts in my five-year-old mind that went on at the time, you know, was, what did I ever do to them? I couldn't understand it, you know, so I must have been just kind of innately, even as a five-year-old boy, I was very obviously effeminate then, you know.
And every school we went to throughout my growing up years of grade school and high school, it was the same thing. My innate, inborn mannerisms were just naturally effeminate. I carried my books like a girl does. I was told all my life, girls carry their books this way, girls do this and boys do that and all of that. I didn't care. I carried the books the way that was comfortable for me.
And I'm sitting right below the classroom where I went in the first grade. Yeah, first grade, and I remember the teacher, she was an older woman, Mrs. Nelson, that was in the classroom right up here. I didn't like her, and she didn't like me. Of course, she's long since passed on, so I like her now better than I ever did. But at any rate, I remember one day I got real angry and upset about something. I was mad and I was all upset, and I stormed out of here, right out through this side entrance, and went home. And we lived about three blocks from here. And I was 6 years old then, and that'd be around 64 years ago. I stormed home and I said to my mother, I'm never going back to there again. And of course, my mother said, oh, yes, you are, you know. And that's kind of been a pattern in my life, you know. If things get a little bit too rough or I get mad or upset, I take off and I say, I'm not going back, you know. And I admire people that can just stay with the same thing or the same church or the same job or whatever, you know, regardless. But with me over the years, when I get upset and say, I storm off and make a change until I get mad at that place. But that's just who I am.
Aunt Margie, I dearly loved my Aunt Margie, who died from pneumonia, double pneumonia, when I was in the second grade, when I was 7 years old. My dad came in and told me that Aunt Margie had died and tried to explain to me what death was all about. And I remember weeping in my bedroom, not understanding all of this, why it happened. Aunt Margie was the one person that gave me solace, was like a refuge from all of the prejudice and bigotry that I, as an effeminate boy, was subjected to. And the one person that I really believed cared for me and loved me as I was taken away, and I didn't understand why. My mother talked my father into selling the property where we were living in Southeast Portland, because I didn't know this then. She shared me with this later, because she was getting ready to divorce my father, and she just couldn't take his drinking and carousing around anymore, and I guess she had warned him. My father did not want her to leave, and I can remember him crying and begging her to change her mind. But her mind was made up. And I remember my father, in trying to get back into my mother's good graces, picked up my sister Teresa and I. My sister Teresa was 4 years old at the time, I was eight. Took us to the movies and bought us clothes and was just lavished all of his affection on us in an attempt to get back into my mother's good graces. He even went so far as to go to the Hinson Memorial Baptist Church here in Portland, Oregon. And when we were driving in the car one night, the Hinson Memorial Baptist Church had their church service on Sunday evenings broadcast. And over the radio, the pastor told of my father's plight, did not give his name, but told how he was begging my mother to take him back and asking everybody to pray. He was anything but religious, believe me. But during that time, when he was trying every ploy he could to get back into my mother's good graces and get her to change her mind, he even had the Baptist preacher pray for him over the radio. But when I was 9 years old, after my mother and father had gotten a divorce, and at that time my father hadn't remarried yet, and my mother remarried and lived in California with my stepfather for a time, and I lived for about a year, year and a half, something like that, out in Sherwood, Oregon, a little country town in the state of Oregon, on my grandmother's farm. And you know, even then, when I was 9 years old, I used to get up on the stumps. There would be stumps where trees had been cut down, you know. And I remember standing up on the stumps, and I would get a coffee can and hold it up like it was a microphone, and I would perform and entertain and preach or whatever, and those cows out in the field were my audience when I was 9 years old. And, or I was a great movie buff too when I was a child.
and I would go out in the field and get up there on the stump and reenact the movies, and the cows would just sit there nonchalantly chewing their cud, but they were very polite, but they were my audience.
And it was right in the spring after the fourth grade was over that Mom and Teresa and Frank came back. You know, to I remember the day clearly when they came back and drove into the driveway from California. And it was in the afternoon, I was out on the yard in the shade with a blanket when here comes the car down the street, and there they were, you know. And I was delighted to see them. And
when I was 12 years old, the neighbors took me to Powellhurst Baptist Church. And I remember one Sunday night, the hymn was sung when they gave the altar call, and the Holy Spirit tugged at my heart. And the invitational hymn that was sung was, "Just as I am without one plea."
And when I was in the 6th, 7th, and 8th grade and early years of high school, I went to a group here in Portland called the Young Oregonians and took tap dancing and baton twirling, and I loved it. And my dad finally made me stop that. He said that, you know, and my stepmother told the tap dancing teacher about me. She says, "We want him to grow up to be a man, not a sissy." And so they put the kibosh on that. It made me stop taking the tap dancing and baton twirling. And I don't think I ever totally got over that or forgave my dad for that, to be honest with you. Well, this is where I went to high school. This right in front of Gresham Union High School in Gresham, Oregon, where I graduated from high school in 1956.
When I got into high school, the publicity when I was a freshman in high school of Christine Jorgensen, the first person publicized transsexual man to have sex change surgery and become a woman, was the headline news story in the papers. And I read Christine's story that was running in This Week magazine as a series. And in Christine Jorgensen's story of her growing up years, she went through the same thing I did. The feelings of wanting to do what society says girls are supposed to do, and just the opposite. And I knew right then that I was really transsexual.
And I told my stepmother, I said, "I relate to this because I feel the same way. I have the same kind of feelings that Christine had." And then I overheard my stepmother telling my father that one day, and he hit the ceiling. He said, "Those kind of people are fairies. They're crazy," and so on and so forth.
And the kids in high school must have instinctively known about me too. Because they automatically without any encouragement from me, they automatically nicknamed me Christine. I was called in my freshman and sophomore years of high school when Christine was the number one news story. I was called Christine, and the boys would say, "Hey, Chris."
Yeah, I was a loner in high school. I didn't go to football or baseball games or any sports, didn't go to the proms. In fact, all my social life in my high school years were spent going to church every night and with church activities. I just came to high school just to, you know, barely apply myself just to barely get enough credits, you know, and move on from here. When I walked past the auditorium, I remember my high school graduation night. I remember I was so afraid I wasn't going to graduate because I didn't really apply myself in my studies in high school. My energies were all really in the church at the time, but that I went to, the Wings of Healing Temple. But actually, all the high school diploma for me in my particular thing was proof that I went to high school. Big deal, you know. When I first went out to see, after I got out of high school, and applied for a job, and it was the very first job I'd ever applied for, and I did get the job, by the way. It was working as a delivery boy for a typewriter ribbon company and carbon paper manufacturer in Portland. This was in 1956. But I had going down for the interview to see about the job. And my mother says to me, "Now, when you walk in there, keep your hands in your pockets." And so I did. I walked in there with my hands in my pockets and sat down, you know, with the interview, had my legs sort of spread in a masculine position like men do, you know, putting on an act.
you know. Well, at any rate, I did get hired for the job, but it didn't take them too long to figure out that that wasn't me. This manly thing with them hands in the pockets and all of this just wasn't me, you know, and it was so obvious. But I was there for about 3 years. To the people that I worked with, I started hearing that there was such a thing as gay bars. And I first heard of Ashley, my boss on my first job. He was not gay, but he was telling me that there was a nightclub in San Francisco called Finocchio's. And he said anytime anybody ever went to San Francisco, they always went to Finocchio's. Anybody who was anybody. One of the main tourist attractions in San Francisco was Finocchio's. And how he worded it then, he said it's run by a bunch of queers who dress up as women. And of course, having had the natural instinct, even when I was quite young, to want to wear women's clothes, feeling more comfortable in women's clothes, I immediately took notice of that. And then about a year before I turned 21, some guy, you know, picked me up in a theater and with the sexual encounter. And he started telling me that a lot of people, he said, are policemen and boxers and firemen who are in typically macho roles are homosexual. And I heard the term gay, and I heard that there was a gay bar in Portland called the Harbor Club. It's no longer there now. It was on 2nd and Yamhill. And there was sort of a bar and restaurant downstairs, and then upstairs was the gay bar. And then right around the corner from the Harbor Club on 1st and Morrison, that has also been torn down now, was a tavern called the Half Moon Tavern. I was always a fan of Sophie Tucker's, the last of the Red Hot Mamas when I got out of high school and I bought all of Sophie's albums. I'm the last of the Red Hot Mamas. She sang back in the 20s, you know. They've all cooled down but me.
Some of these days.
And when Sophie was 80 years old and she was a big, heavy-set Jewish woman, she still was talking about the more candles on my birthday cake, the hotter I become. She kept that positive attitude and kept on going, and that has had a powerful influence on my life.
I feel so lonely. Cause you know, honey, you've always had your way. And when you leave me, you know it's gonna grieve me. Gonna miss your big fat mama, your mama, some of these days.
But I met Jackie and Esther, these two lesbians here in Portland. One back then, in the late 50s, the lesbian couples were mostly butch and femme. And Jackie wore her hair very short, did factory worker work like a man does, wore men's clothing. The only thing that Jackie wore that was feminine was a bra because she had big boobs. And her lover Esther was the femme counterpart. But I met Jackie and Esther at the Harbor Club. And we became very good friends. And then Jackie and Esther moved to Oakland. So I moved to Oakland, and the only reason I ended up in Oakland instead of San Francisco at that time was because Jackie and Esther were there, and I was able to stay with them until I got a job, and I got a job taking dishes and trays off of a conveyor belt at the Colonial Cafeteria in Oakland. And every weekend I would go over, we get paid on Friday, I'd go over Friday night across the bay to Finocchio's, and they had four shows back in those days, and sat through all four shows almost every week, and I wanted to be up on that stage doing those numbers so bad.
I was still living as a boy, but I was very uncomfortable in the male role. As a boy, it was very hard for me to find the social acceptance that I craved. And I met another person who was a transsexual who was getting ready to start to live as a woman. And I knew that if people knew me as a woman, they would accept me as a person. And I set out in my life to prove exactly that. Oh, how well I remember the very first time that I went out in public in female attire. So one night, I called up this friend of mine, Laura, the transsexual who was giving me support, and said, I'm going to go out as a woman tonight. And she said, oh, really? Well, why don't you come over to my place? And I said, okay, and I hung up the phone, and I thought, oh, now I can't get out of it.
A man in public, biological male, could be arrested for cross-dressing. And unless it was on Halloween or a masquerade party or something like that. And so they would take the police would arrest the person if they suspected it was a cross-dresser. They'd have to go down to the police station and have a matron check out what they have between their legs to determine what their sex is. So that also put pressure on transgendered people to have sex change surgery so they could avoid arrest that way and snub their nose at the matron.
And I did it. I got out on the streets in Oakland. I'll never forget that night if I live to be 100. And every time, if a police car was even 6 blocks away, I froze because I was absolutely fearful. But I managed to get over to Laura's apartment. And I went on the bus, the public transit system. And then on the way back from her home, I was the only one sitting in the back of the bus, and I remember somebody got on the bus and was talking to the driver, and I thought they were looking at me, and I was absolutely, literally terrified, and I got off at the next stop and got in a cab and went home the rest of the way.
And so at any rate, but I was on the female hormones then. When I, the first year I was living as Paula, I was working in the insurance company, I was going to Dr. Benjamin, the doctor, the sexologist who had coined the term transsexual in the first place. He was also Christine Jorgensen's doctor when all the publicity, you know, in the early 50s came out about her. A shot every week and a pill every day. Laura and I used to have, you know, for breast development, and actually the estrogen actually feminizes you all over. And but I mean, Laura and I used to have a standing joke, you know, about the hormones and the estrogen. A pill a day keeps the falsies away.
And I had built up a feminine attire wardrobe by then. In fact, I had two sets of clothes, a set of boys' clothes and a set of women's clothes. And I remember one time when I was talking on a job where I was working where they did not know of my sexuality, that slipped out. And I said, oh, I have a charge account at this store where I get my men's clothes. And they looked at me kind of funny, as if to what other kind of clothes would you get? But I went one Sunday morning to the First Assembly of God Church in Oakland, California. And I had gotten identity established. I wasn't living as a woman yet, but I got ID as Paula. Nielsen is my legal last name. And the only thing I changed was the first name. And I went to the Sunday morning worship service at the Assembly of God Church, and the people treated me like they would treat any other woman who was new in the church, a single young woman. I was in my early 20s then at that time, and a couple from the church invited me to their house for dinner afterwards. And all these years that I had attended the Assemblies of God churches here in Portland as a boy, and then going to the same type of a church in Oakland as a woman, the way I was treated was completely and totally different. I felt like a real person, like they were accepting the person that God sees and that God accepts. Within a short time, I got rid of all of the boys' clothes. I moved out of the apartment I was living in Oakland and moved over to San Francisco. And this was on May the 1st, 1963. I did not take a stitch of male clothing with me.
The first year I lived as Paula, I had my picture taken in a photographic session at Glad Tidings Assembly of God Church in San Francisco. And they had it in the church directory, and I ordered copies of it.
You were saying that, you know, in these places and in the church that you went to after that, you wouldn't be necessarily singing in the choir if they knew. How do you reconcile that in your brain? Like, do you tell yourself that? I know that you said that, you know, God knows, and that's really all that matters. But most people in that situation would constantly be looking over their shoulders saying, if they ever figure this out, I'm done. Like,
well,
it would be a nervous thing.
Of course the thought is entered my mind. Yeah, it would. In fact, the thing of it, Laura and I, we broke away when we changed, you know, moved over from Oakland to San Francisco. We broke away from our gay friends completely. And because Laura was working as a woman, as a hairdresser in a shop, where, you know, before she moved over to San Francisco, and this one gay man, this queen, found out that she was working and called, dropped the dime on her, that were and called the employer and said, you know, you have a man there who was a woman. So therefore, we were scared to death of gay people, and so we lived pretty much in the straight culture, you know, always worried that some vicious queen or somebody would get pissed if they knew that I was working on a job as a woman where they didn't know I was biologically male. Somebody, a gay person or somebody, could get mad that knew the story and get mad and call the employer and tell on you. So therefore, we lived under that fear at that time.
Paula sent a picture back, and this is right after Larry became Paula, and I remember looking at Larry as Paula, thinking, wow, because Paula was slim with red hair, dressed up really nice, and Paula was absolutely beautiful. And I said, well, you know, hey, maybe this is meant to be, because Larry looks great as Paula. And so it was surprising to us at first, but if that's what, you know, was meant to be, so.
No. My father never accepted it. He's the only one in the family that didn't.
So what did he speak to you about it? Could you be around him, or did he just completely cut you off?
Well, yeah, we kind of cut each other off. It was even before I transitioned in identity. I have not seen him since 1960.
In the summer, spring or summer, I think it was, of 1964, I moved from San Francisco to Los Angeles. I had a transsexual friend who had lived in Huntington Park, California, who said that I could stay with her when I first got there until I got myself situated and got to working and got another apartment. And I was younger and slimmer, and I had good secretarial skills, so finding work in Los Angeles back in those days was no problem at all. You know, in fact, I'll share this with you. I was hired at Hartford Insurance Company in 1964. They hired me, and so I went in to report for work, and they had some forms to fill out, and the lady said to me and a couple of other new employees that had just been hired that this is your doctor's appointment, that we require you to take a physical examination with the company doctor, and gave me the slip with the name and the address and the appointment time for me to go see their doctor for a pre-employment physical. Well, you know, I hadn't had sex change surgery. And of course, you know, because of the genital thing being male, I walked out the door with the slip and never went to the doctor and never went back. But at any rate, a day or two later, I was sitting there on 6th and Spring Street in downtown Los Angeles in 1964, and there was a little ad, and it just said, it didn't say it was a law firm, it just said transcriber, that was it, transcriber, you know, typist, insurance experience helpful. So I went in there and went up the elevator, walked down the hall to that address and to that room number, and it said law offices. And I thought, oh dear, I'm not a legal secretary. And I turned around and walked back, got in the elevator, and walked down. And then I felt that inner voice, the tap on the shoulder from the Lord, saying, you know, the ad didn't ask for legal experience, it just said insurance experience. So I went back up, walked in the door. They hired me on the spot. I think they didn't give me a little typing test. And of course, it was a small firm. There was no pre-employment physical. And they hired me, and I'd worked there for quite at least 2 years, 2.5 years at the firm. Well, anyway, back to Huntington Park, staying with the transsexual friend of mine, Alicia was her name. I had one gay friend, Steve, but other than that, I knew nobody in LA. And I was sitting there and I was so down, and all of a sudden I started reminiscing to my teenage days when I was in, you know, my junior and senior years of high school, when all of a sudden my mind flashed on the fact that this same ministry that I went to back in the 50s, in 1959, had moved to Los Angeles. So I walked in there, and there was Dale Young, one of their ministers at the time, in the lobby. And I walked in and told him, you know, that I listened to Dr. Wyatt over the radio, Dr. Thomas Wyatt, who had the Wings of Healing radio ministry for years. In fact, at one time, it was the world's largest religious broadcast of any kind. And so Dale Young said, well, Dr. Wyatt just passed away 2 weeks ago. I had just missed his funeral by a week, but Evelyn Wyatt, his wife, whom Dr. Wyatt left the ministry to, took it over and eventually took over the radio ministry. So I started attending church there with the same people that knew me as Larry 9 or 10 years ago in Portland. And one of the workers in the office kind of picked up on it. She says, oh, she says, you remind me of a boy in Portland. And then Roberta, one of the people in the office, she says, you might know it, but you have a twin brother in Portland, Oregon. As if I didn't know, you know. I wasn't about to come out and tell them then, this was back in 1964, that Larry and Paula were one and the same. I don't think they would have accepted that. So I lied and denied and said I didn't know anything about who this person was. There were some people that wondered, you know, after all, I was tall, one thing, and looked the same and had the same last name. Paula was accepted by these people in a way that Larry never was accepted. Larry was tolerated in a friendly way, but and when they knew me as Paula, I was accepted.
And then the Holy Spirit directed me to Angelus Temple in Los Angeles, that wonderful church that was built by the late Amy Semple McPherson, the headquarter church for the International Church of the Four Square Gospel.
Sister McPherson lived before my time. In fact, Sister McPherson passed away in 1944. At that time, I was only 6 years old. In her biographies, Amy McPherson was quoted as saying, Angelus Temple, from its silver doors, crystal doors, clear up to its radio tower, I love every inch of it. And for a couple of years in my life, back in 1965, aside from my regular 9-to-5 secretarial job, I practically lived in Angelus Temple.
And this was in my early days of living as a woman. And there were times when I did things that I probably wouldn't have done had I been raised as a girl in the first place. Some of these older ladies were at Angelus Temple in the early days of the temple. And of course, back in the 20s, you know, the women were wearing short skirts, but the women in the Pentecostal churches didn't wear makeup. Jan Crouch, bless her heart, on Trinity Broadcasting, who comes from the Assemblies of God, now wears more makeup, the makeup and wigs of three people combined. But there was a time when women who were Pentecostal just didn't do that. And so I had this dress I was wearing. It really wasn't that short when I stood up. It came right around below the knees. But it was one of those kind of dresses that when I sat down, it slid up to about 2 inches above the knees. I'll tell you, those old ladies there from the old days of Angelus Temple were not amused, and they complained to Sister Smith, who was in charge of all of the services in the 500 room. And this one lady got up, she was very elderly, and she said, and this was directed to me, no doubt about it. She says, I'll tell you why we're not having a revival. She says, it's these women and their short dresses. She says, back when Sister was here, we had our robes and we wore our long skirts. And she just emphasized that the Holy Spirit couldn't move because of these women in their short dresses. And you know, when I was sharing this with Laura, my transsexual friend later, and I said to him, if she had had any idea what was under that dress, as far as the genitals go, she probably would have went right out into the power and had a heart attack right then. I'm not making fun of it, but it is kind of a humorous thing, you know.
And at that time, I don't know why, but I prayed that God would give me some kind of a confirmation that I was in God's will by living as Paula. And one Sunday afternoon in the service, the minister that I was secretary to had me stand up and acknowledge that the Holy Spirit had sent me into her life as her secretary. And she had me stand up in that service at Angela's Temple, and she said, and these words have burned into my sight. She said, "This is the girl that God gave me." And I knew in that moment that I had the confirmation from God that I had been praying for. And since that day to this very day that we're sitting here and talking, I have never questioned the fact that I know that living as Paula Nielsen, I am in the perfect center of God's will.
I even worked for a couple of years for the William Morris Agency in Beverly Hills, California, which is the oldest and largest theatrical agency in the country, as secretary to the controller. That was in 1967 through 1969.
The controller, who I was secretary to, was very demanding. He did not have patience with so many of these secretaries back in those days. I was told were slow pokes, you know. I go into an temp job, and as soon as they saw my typing skills, they offered me a job. And then I was dealing with movie stars. You know, the thing I loved about when I first worked with William Morris was meeting these movie stars in person. You know, George Hamilton came into the office, and Jimmy Durante, and Colonel Tom Parker, who was Elvis Presley's manager and has been for years, came into the office all the time.
There was a secretary there at the William Morris Agency one day when Steve McQueen came in, you know, and she blushed and just carried on, and I thought, well, how ridiculous. Well, that was how I reacted toward Warren Beatty. The chauffeur, the black guy who came into the office quite a bit, who was the chauffeur to Mr. Lastfogle, he was chummy and good friends with Warren Beatty. Warren Beatty lived in the penthouse of the Beverly Wilshire Hotel, which is just a block away from there. I'm not totally sure now, but I think that's when he was having his little fling with Julie Christie. But I was carrying on to the Emil, I think his name was, or something, the chauffeur. Oh, I said, Warren Beatty just turns me on, la, la, la. So he came up to the office one day. I was getting ready to go home at the end of the day, and he says, Warren is downstairs in Mr. Lastfogle's office, and I told him about you, and he would like to meet you. Oh, no, my God, I acted like a schoolgirl. Oh, come on, you've been talking, you want to meet him and everything. And I said, oh, God, no. I said, I just, no. And so I snuck out the back door and went home and missed my opportunity to meet Warren Beatty. But Emil did get a picture of him. It was on the set of Bonnie and Clyde, who they were making at the time. And it said, "To Paula, love Warren." Oh, I almost went out under the power. But at any rate, like I say, I had the chance to meet Warren Beatty, and I snuck out the back door like a big chicken, like a coward, and went home. Oh, well, that's life, you know. I don't think Warren Beatty would have ever married me anyway. And if we had had a little fling, you know, then he would have had to find out what I was, you know. So, oh, dear.
Over my life, there have been times when I have done, in moments of anger, I have done stupid things. And I should know, I think I've learned that lesson after all these years. Don't ever make changes or decisions when you're angry. You know, 9 times out of 10, you're gonna regret it later. And, but one day, Mr. Goldberg was in a bad mood, and I forgot what he gave me some instructions on in something. I walked in, and, "Why don't you follow instructions?" he said. And I blew up, and I said, "I'm so tired of being chewed out." I said, "Forget it, I'm out of here," and went out and stormed out of the office. Personnel manager called me later and said, you know, "You're done."
A lot of people think, you know, that when a biologically male trans person takes female hormones, that it does the breast development, and they don't think beyond that. But that's only a small part of the effect that it has. But I had adverse side effects from it, from the hormone pills, where I got very moody and emotional. It was like Dr. Benjamin said, it was like a woman going through menopause. And while I've had my crushes on men off and on over the years, when I was on the female hormones, my goodness, a guy could just smile and open the door for me, and I was in love, you know. And I did go up these up and down mood swings. And so I stayed on the hormones. I moved to LA in 64 and was still on them.
Then I would experiment and go off of them for a couple of months, and I wouldn't have all of these mood swing things. However, I did over the years maintain a certain amount of breast development in spite of it all. It's been a number of years now since I've had the hormone things. But then in the, I think it was, I went back on them for a while in the, around 1969, 1970, I went through a doctor in Beverly Hills. And I told him about the side effects I had from the estrogen therapy, and he said about 35% of the transsexual patients that he has treated have that. The first few years I was living as Paula, that's all I thought about, was having the sex change surgery. And but then as the time went on, I realized that I was happy living the way that I was. I was happy with my sex life the way that it was at that time. What I did is nobody's business. And so I really, you know, as time went on, I realized I was happy just the way I was. So I didn't really need the sex change surgery. I remember when Stonewall happened in 1969, I was working at Lowe's Theaters then, and I remember hearing about it, and that was back when Troy Perry started Metropolitan Community Church. Is interestingly enough, right during within a year of Stonewall and the beginning of the gay liberation movement is when Troy Perry started Metropolitan Community Church. And my friend Steve tried to get me involved in Metropolitan Community Church back then. This was 1969 in L.A. And I said, oh, no. I said, I can't afford to be publicly involved with a gay group.
When I founded MCCO, I received a letter from Paula Nielsen.
That's me. But I didn't have my name on it, though.
That's right.
I had my address.
That's right.
Yeah.
Had an address, but didn't have a name. But I wrote you back.
Yes, you did.
And didn't know who it was from.
You said it's always great to hear from interesting people, and that you are. I remember that.
That's right, because you told me your life story.
Yes.
And I said you were welcome to come to the church, if I remember right, and I hoped you would come. And the first time I met you, where it was so strange.
The Encore Theater.
That's right. People ask me sometimes because when they meet you, you know, I said, even then, I said, she came to the altar. And I said, for communion.
Right.
And when I served her communion, she threw up her hands like we Pentecostal.
I did. I just automatically did it.
And yep. And I knew immediately. I said, oh, my God, another Pentecostal.
Right.
And that was the connection.
In the very first meeting, Metropolitan Community Church was in a home in Huntington Park, California, with 12 people. Today, there's how many churches all over the world?
Almost 325
300
countries.
Churches.
So I was working at the William Morris Agency when all of a sudden I noticed guys, teenage guys, were letting their hair grow and walking down Hollywood Boulevard with long hair. Up until then, men didn't wear long hair. They was strictly crew cuts or their hair cut real short. So at any rate, but the hippie thing started, and the pot, the marijuana and the LSD was the big drug in that day. And at first, I was definitely not into it at all. When I had moved into this apartment building in L.A., it was on Las Palmas between Melrose and Santa Monica. And right across the hall from me, there were some hippies. There were hippies living in the upstairs in the building, too, that I became real good friends with. This was in 1970. They were in their 20s. There was quite a few of them. There was Alan Joyce. Well, they lived in the Echo Park area, but Al's best, and Al is the one who turned me on to smoking pot originally back then in 1970. It was right after Janis Joplin died that all this happened. And then Joe, who lived across the hall from me, had gone through the military with Al, and they were hippies, and they were doing LSD and all that stuff. And even though I was hobnobbing with them, they were kind of my, for about 3 years, they were my family.
Friday nights, we'd sit and party and smoke pot, and I'd always get stoned and spaced out and forget that I had it in my hand. And then when I handed it to the next person, the joint going around the room, it was dead. And I remember Al one night says, I'm tired of you handing me these dead joints all night. They called me Humphrey. You know, Bogart, that joint, Humphrey. And but now some of them, that crowd did do acid, but I didn't. I stayed away from LSD. I knew that was screwing me up.
And that was when I got into Janis Joplin and the Pearl album, and me and Bobby McGee. And I was very took up with Bob Dylan, the Highway 61 Revisited, and also the Rolling Stones, Mick Jagger. and the rock stars of that time. But one thing that really kept me going spiritually back in that time was listening to Catherine Kuhlman every morning on the radio during the week at 8 o'clock. Her program was on, her radio program, and I always started my day off with Catherine Kuhlman. I used to joke with friends of mine and say, how many people start off their day with Catherine Kuhlman and then end their day with Janis Joplin? But that was just me.
But in 1976, I was in Los Angeles, and I knew it was God's will for me to come back to Portland. And I was in touch with my dear, longtime friend, Sylvia Pennington. My finances were totally depleted, and I was kind of a rough time of my life. And every time that Sylvia would pray with me, she said, Paula, you have a ministry in Portland, and it is God's will that you go back to Portland at this time.
In 1976, Reverend A. Austin Amron, an openly gay man who was formerly for many years a successful minister in the Assemblies of God, started Metropolitan Community Church here in Portland, and then about a year later in 77, the congregation under Austin's leadership purchased this wonderful building here on the corner, this historic church, as I've just said, on the corner of Northeast 24th and Broadway. And my involvement in Metropolitan Community Church of Portland was kind of my first step out of my own particular closet. And it was kind of my first entrance as Paula back into the gay community from the time back in 1963 when I exited the gay community, when I stopped living as Larry and started living as Paula. And I was the very first, and I'm proud to say this, happy and proud to say it, I was the very first church secretary that Portland Metropolitan Community Church had. That's right. And I practically lived in this church back in those days. I also became editor of the church newsletter and was also involved in a ministerial training program. But I was studying, taking correspondence courses, working as the church secretary. I was preaching in the church from time to time and studying, you know, to become an MCC minister, which at that time I thought was my calling. It was during the time that I was typing the church bulletin in Austin's living room in 1976-1977 when Anita Bryant started her famous Save the Children crusade against homosexuals in Dade County in Miami, Florida. The gay community lost that election, and Austin was so discouraged. He said, this is going to set gay rights back. And I said, not necessarily. I said, if one thing Anita Bryant did for the gay people, she got us to get off of our duffs and get out there and do something and fight the prejudice and the bigotry that gay people have endured, the persecution for centuries. And Anita Bryant, made by making a political issue out of the gay scene, was really lit the fire under the gay community, as it were, to get out and start fighting for gay rights and gay freedom. So we really, Anita Bryant, even though she didn't mean it as a favor, Anita Bryant did do a great favor to the gay community.
Oh, we are able to go up and take the country, to possess the land from Jordan to the sea. Though the giants may be there, our way to hinder, God will surely give us victory. Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he fought me.
And the day that they won that Dade County thing, they were singing Victory in Jesus while a group of us gay Christians at the Metropolitan Community Church of Portland were also singing Victory in Jesus.
To victory beneath the cleansing flood.
The very first openly gay law firm in the city of Portland was in the fall of 1980 when Catherine English and Janet Metcalf started the firm of English and Metcalf, advertising, serving the gay community.
Well, we had our office space, but we had nothing in it. We had no furniture. The only thing we had was a phone on the floor. So we opened up the office at 9 o'clock that morning, and suddenly the phone never stopped ringing. We had people calling all over. And I said, Janet, we have got to get a legal secretary. We've got to get